It's a great pleasure and honor this evening that we have Vitaly Komar as our visiting speaker. Most of you are too young to remember the Cold War and what it was like between the antagonisms between Russia and the United States. When I was in public school here in the United States, we had these drills that were duck and cover, and you had to go under your desk just in case an atomic bomb hit you, as if that was going to make any difference. And someone like Vitaly Komar has experienced life on both sides of the changing dynamics of the Iron Curtain and the ways in which communism has been essentially changed. And I still can't say who won what, because we're all in the same boat. So basically, I'd like to introduce a great artist from Russia and from New York, Vitaly Komar. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for such a beautiful introduction. First, I am sorry for my New York accent, but if somebody don't understand what I am speaking about, please feel free to ask me, ask any questions after this presentation. one of the reasons I really loved Cezanne and Cubism when I was a young student in Moscow, art student in Moscow, was that Cezanne speak a broken classical style visual language. It literally was broken on the kind of facets, because Paul Cezanne was dreaming to paint like classical academical style, Poussin, etc. But nature of his great gift was against visual language of Poussin and Academy. And his visual language was broken visual language. And who knows, maybe my English someday will be quite useful for art historian. And sorry again for my my Vitaly Komar English. I was born in Soviet Union, last century, of course. And I just like to remind you that it was a very special kind of totalitarian country. It was no independent art galleries, art magazines, or art newspaper. Everything belonged to state. Galleries, all galleries belong to state. All sale of art materials belong to state. All sale and purchases of the artwork belong to state. All newspaper, as I said, and art magazines belong to state. And I belong to very small group of the artists, so-called unofficial artists, or we made the underground art, and some official artists call us non-conformist artists. We had a lot of terms, but what was a common that we have no possibility to show our works. It was very difficult and almost illegal. And one of the reasons that in 1974 we decide to go to the open air show, open door show, open air show in park in Moscow, capital of the Soviet Union, Soviet Russia. Because it was only place when possibly we don't need the permission of the government to show our work. We had a kind of folding easels, and our work. Suddenly, some people in civil dress, which represent the government, appear, start to block our works, beat artists, and artists who resist was even arrested. It was one of the most strong impression of art life in my life. In some way, it was a tragedy for artists. But from other way, I think it was the great moment in my life. Maybe every artist dreaming secretly to be destroyed by somebody. That means you touch spectators so strong and so greatly that spectator like to destroy your work. A lot of course, different feeling about this subject. It was one of the reasons when I left Russia and became part of the Western life, Western artistic life, Western art world. My first show on the West was in late 70s in Ronald Feldman Gallery. After that, it was I became part of that. And all my life, I try to found a good friend relationship. And I found a lot. For example, for a long time, I used to work with my old friend, Alex Melamed. We established the, in early 70s in Russia, we established the Soz Art movement. It was a unique movement which tried to make a bridge between official art language and unofficial art messages, kind of to bridging these two kind of art. You know, any members, from my point of view, I understand collaboration in art very brightly. From my point of view, every members of movement, of art movements, even art style, people who sharing style, even the centuries between these people, they're collaborators. For example, all Cubist artists, from my point of view, they work in collaboration. Picasso, Braque, and another artist, they create huge phenomena which we call Cubism. It was a collective, collaborative work. And we established such a movement which we call Soz Art, and coined this term, Soz Art, from socialist art, kind of socialist art. And for many years, I used to work with Alex Melamed. But on the West, we had also experience to work with Western artists. For example, we made the first work in collaboration with pioneer of video art, Douglas Davis, with Fluxus musician Charlotte Moorman in 1976. It was also one of the first work of in collaboration of between Russian and American artists. I made the one work with in collaboration with Andy Warhol and one project which he was also involved. I used to work in collaboration with animals, with elephants, paint with elephants. Elephants has ability to keep the brushes, believe it or not. I work with masses through the Paul Company, asking, making survey, thousand and thousand people collaborate with me and my friends. Focus groups was also, we're asking people what kind of art you like to see, what kind of art majority of the population of different countries like to see. That means even now when I consider myself more individual work, I understand that I'm working in collaboration with art history. I couldn't jump out from my visual language. I took all art history as a kind of dictionary, which I speak like Russian-English dictionary you have. But that's a kind of mixture of my family album and art history album. And some of the art historian artwork even closer than some of my relatives' photographs in my family album. I belong to family of the artist, which quite old, maybe older than any aristocratic family in Great Britain. And I work in collaboration. I said collaboration is a kind of family business. That's why, for example, members of one movement looks a little bit like each other. For example, compare cubism of Picasso and some cubistic work of the Braque. They look a little similar. But the same way brothers and sisters look in one family. Because collaboration in art history, collaboration in one movement, it's family business, I believe. We're relatives, all of us relatives. That's why album of art history I take as my family album. And I work in collaboration now with my family. I'll show you a little bit part of history, because I have, as I said, experience work in West and East, in US and SU, both countries. On the screen, you see the image and text. This is the image, very simple metaphor, eye and grapes, and text. I will translate this text. Clear consciousness is a result of our bad memory. And the most important for me, the line. You see the line, you follow this red hero of this presentation, red dot. That's the line between image and text. But it's not necessarily visible line. For example, now I'm speaking, you see the text, you're listening to the text of my lips. But on the screen, you see the image. And the relation of this text context and the work itself always fascinated me all my life. I'll give you example which really shocked me when I was a young artist. At this time was famous work of Van Gogh, which many experts and art historians consider as a masterpiece of Van Gogh. But later, some people found that in paint, oil paint of this painting, have a kind of cobalt. And cobalt in color was used after Van Gogh's death. That means this beautiful, fantastic painting was a forgery. And all art experts, all art lovers, stopped to admire it. What's happened? The line was broken between text and image. Because this image used to exist in the context of the great life, almost Jesus Christ of art history, Van Gogh. But one of the most expensive as well artists. But painting not change. Painting is still the same, but we stop to admire. And in many cases, our knowledge of the painting, our knowledge of the life of the artist is making important background, important part of the image, in our perception of the image. And this is one of the most strangest phenomena of art history. Depends that all our criterions very ephemeral sometimes. And change perception, you change art itself, believe it or not. Piece of art not change, perception change. You can say, oh, we don't know some name and life of some great ancient artist. For example, nobody know who created the Venus of Milo, for example. Of course, we don't know the biography of the artist, but we know context of existence of Greek sculpture. It's a context of the great part of history of humanity, the great part of history of marble itself, relation of artist and marble, the beginning of the realistic depiction of naked body, etc. and also religion. We know the cult of Venus. We know the many things. And you know better, you understand better. That's mean all spectators divided. Some people knows a little bit, some people knows more. Some people say, I don't like to know anything about artists. I just see nice color, vibrant color, dynamic composition. Yes, of course, it's freedom of choice. You can choose this way. But in this case, you understand that in other people, much more educated than you, their perception of art different. And not only in art, even behavior of more educated people different. Even their language different. Even their way of life different. Many different things depend of your knowledge. Knowledge can give you kind of power. But of course, absence of knowledge also can give you power. I have no answer. My work just raising questions, no answer, any question. But I'll try to the end of presentation answer some of your questions. Okay, I have a lot of images. I try to, I'm not going to show all of them because I believe I bring too much of them. Next, triptych. You see the line between image and text became kind of two lines, and the diptych became triptych. You see the same eye and grapes, the same sentence, but another metaphor also related eye through the this eye. And these two lines between text and image very important for me. This is a line between two images, abstract image and realistic image about death, love and death. And text is about Sigmund Freud, that Sigmund Freud loved sour cream very much. That's also diptych which combine a few styles, Russian icon, depiction of Christ, and suprematism, cross, and more realistic image, Lenin, Russian leader, leader of Russian Revolution, with skeleton of Karl Marx, philosopher who was a kind of god for Lenin and all communists. And also you see the line, this line. That means it's also line between two different texts. This is a text of visual languages, but line between them very important. Because this line is a compressing of the centuries which divide the styles. I'll show you if a little bit my childhood at public school of Soviet totalitarian country. This is a public art of socialist realism depicted Lenin on this pedestal. This is my public school, and also Lenin on the background of red triangle. I'd like to focus your attention on something maybe you don't notice from the first point of view. Duality of this images. Because Russia geographically and traditionally between East and West, and some Western tradition, modern tradition, related to very old tradition, and some Eastern tradition related to European tradition related to Asian tradition. It's a kind of basic duality. And artists always express this duality. For example, look at this line between realistic Lenin and Cuba futuristic pedestal. And now you see that is the two styles which represent two important periods of Soviet-Russia art history. Russian avant-garde, Cuba futuristic, and socialist realism later came in Stalin time. With realistic academical style depiction of Lenin. The same thing with this very realistic academical style of bust of Lenin. Each public school has this bust. We were surrounded by so-called propaganda art, agitprop art. And this triangle, it's a symbol of this red tie. Red tie is a symbol of Soviet Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts in this school. And this red triangle also reference to Russian suprematism. That means, again, we see kind of line between two different kind of languages, visual languages. That's maybe one of the origin of my interest to this problem, relation of different languages. Like if you see the Russian-English dictionary, you see the line from one, on the left you see the Russian words, on the right you see the English words. If you studied French, you have a Frenchy on the left, and on the right you see English words. I recommend actually to everybody to speak at least one more language, even broken language is good. Because from my experience, and my experience of relation with somebody who studied another language, it's really good development of your imagination. Not only linguistic imagination, but also visual imagination as well. That's one of the conceptual eclecticism, a combination of many styles. If some of my work, you see this school girl sitting on bust of Stalin in realistic style, her body developing in style of mixture of geometry and expressionism, and so on, and ended by minimalism. This is a hero of ancient mythology, Minotaur, human body and the animal head. You see the animal head executed in expressionistic style and human body in classical style as a kind of pedestal as well. And relation between these styles is very important for me. In 80s, many artists in time of postmodernism used this method. But in Russia, we started to do it in early 70s. But it was an iron curtain and information about these searches in our circle of Moscow artists was not well known. Sometimes expressionism could be part of the realistic painting. You see the depiction of the Stalin and he holding the bloody arm. By Freud, bloody arm cut by any knife or by a sword. Stalin has a sword. It's a symbol of the castration anxiety. This story, which illustrated this painting, it's related to really Freudian story which happened with my girlfriend at my public school time. When Stalin died, in this day, when all newspaper was announced that, she had first time in her life, she found the first drop of blood on her paint, on her underwear. And the title of this painting, First Drop of Blood. Sometimes painting has no line, but it's also invisible line. For example, this is a origin of socialist realism. Muse tracing the shadow of Stalin profile on this wall. But if you make the line here between her and Stalin, you see the difference between classical style and socialist realism style. This painting related to my childhood impression. Last time I saw my father when I was 6 years old, that's why I project image of my father on many people which surrounded me. And one of the official title of the Stalin was the father of nation. I believe in public school you studied the George Washington and Thomas Jefferson also with such a title, the fathers of nation. In this case, Soviet Russia was no exception, but I was a naive child, and I really some evening together with my grandfather, I saw the car, and I was sure, maybe I was wrong, that Stalin looked at the back window on me. Our eye close each other, contact each other. And this painting dedicated to this moment in my life. And now it's in collection of a Museum of Modern Art, and I really happy that my childhood impression we can see. it was long ago. Image of red flag, you know, the red, in Russian language, red is mean beautiful. I'll show you a few examples of image of red flag. This is a witches in a kind of expressionist style, which using the flag, red flag as a brooms. And Bolsheviks return home after demonstration, and they stop to see this green elephant, which in Russian language equivalent of pig elephant, green dragon. Here the line between naive realist image and abstract painting. You see the green and red flag make a relation between these two different styles. This is a one day and night in the life of the actress. This is the actress at during the performing on the movie studio with red flag, and her night after she is sleeping, drinking. Red flag itself, it's a huge canvas, now in a private collection in London, and I make the invisible line or visible line between this work and Jasper John's flag. Because in some parallel between thoughts art, which I belong to, and pop art, which belong to art history of United States. You know, sometimes political images became kind of pop images. Basically, American pop art related to commercials and advertising of the products which we consume. And thoughts art related to propaganda of political ideas. But you know, sometimes structure of propaganda and commercial very close. I can say propaganda of Coca-Cola, or I can say commercial of communist ideas. That means both of them, propaganda and commercials, they try to manipulate your mind. They try to promote something, idea or product. That's why I found a lot of similarity to American pop art and conceptual pop art, and specifically to Marcel Duchamp, who was one of the founder of both conceptual art and pop art in the early century. Also, I love Marcel Duchamp because he was also immigrant. Before United States and New York became center of cultural life and artistic world, he moved to New York from Paris at a time when Paris was the capital of the world. He had a really nose, he had the intuition, he saw the future. And in some way, I follow his way. It was simple way which first immigrants to America way follow. They follow the sun movement from the east to west under horizon. And in this direction, some criminals and religious fanatics from the Europe discovered the America. And after they move from the East Coast to West Coast, the same way. The sun, magic of the sunlight, sun rays, magic of sunset. Red color of red flag really attract people. In Russian language, as I said, red is mean beautiful, the same words using for that. I tried to make a reference to Jasper Jones flag. You see the Jasper Jones flag and my reference. This is a Yalta conference. If you remember the end of the war, Second War, and victory over the Nazis, in Crimea was the conference in Yalta City when three leaders of the UK, United States, and Soviet Russia met each other. And they established the rules of the United Nations, especially Security Council. They tried to found the structure how to avoid another World War III. It was important conference of the victories. When I saw this first time, this photograph, I was shocked by eclecticism, invisible eclecticism of these three images. You see, you can see the line between Churchill and Roosevelt, line between Stalin and Roosevelt. What's united these different people? Common enemy, Nazi Hitler state. But they're different. This is a bloody dictator. This is a so-called democratically elected president and the servant of Her Majesty Queen. And they sitting all together. That's, we living in time, I understood, when term synthesis almost the lost difference to term eclecticism. Today, eclecticism is a play role of contemporary way to synthesis. It's a great semantic victory of the contemporary language. And this is a reflection of American flag, Great Britain flag, and Soviet flag in style of Jasper Jones. This is a project which I did for City Art Foundation together with Alex Melamed. In the 80s, late 80s, for United Nations wall, because they are founders of the United Nations, as I said, rules of United Nations, three of them. And I use political mythology cliché, Russia as a bear, American eagle, and British lion. And believe it or not, we received first payment from it was approved by City Art Foundation. We received the first payment, but after that it was restricted by community board. And first time I met kind of censorship in the United States. Of course, everybody knows about, everybody knew and knows about the Soviet-Russia censorship. But this experience was first time in my life. I spoke with community board, I had a meeting, and I asked them of the reason, et cetera. It was even newspaper, New York newspaper covered this story. They said, we afraid of graffiti of protesters because the around the United Nations, some big population of the immigrants from Poland. Because you know the all art, all Russian history, Russia make neighbors part of the kind of empire. And Poland was really very much anti-Soviet country because Russia was, Poland was conquered by Russians a few times. That was one of the reasons. And they consider Stalin as a kind of evil. I tried to argue, of course, I said that even in Catholic Church, Poland is a Catholic country, even in Catholic Church you see the depiction of the devils, depiction of the evil. It's not a lot of interesting theological ideas about relation of evil and good. That's God, Lord God permit to Satan became fallen angel because to give us a freedom of choice. That was a great gift. Anyway, I couldn't really influenced them, and the project just became one of the many ephemeral projects which I did during my life. But this public art project succeeded. It's a Holland red light district. In the same years, the Museum of Gaag, the capital of the Holland, invite a few international artists and ask to create something for public art of the capital of Holland. I really love Holland, and I love the country. I love the 17th century art, 19th century art, 20th century art, such artists like Mondrian was one of the pioneers of the abstract art in art history. I love the Dutch herring, actually. If somebody loves herring, I recommend it. The best herring in Holland, in May. It's something like Japanese sushi, so almost a little bit salty and fresh. And also, everybody see the strange similarity. Red light district. Prostitution legalized in Holland since 17th century and now. Red light district and red color of red flag, Soviet red flag. It was a kind of parallel, and it gives the idea of this installation. This is a public telephone booth which you can use only in alarm situation to call to police of the fire department. And Stalin biased inside of these telephone booths. Installation in the red light district. Relation between, also herring. By idea, every day, people working in this area must to change fresh herring on this table. And also red light inside. You see the workers of this part of town here in the windows, and you see this telephone booths. It was very popular and printed postcard, greetings from Holland. Red color is really mysterious. For example, if you're driving car, you must to stop. Red car restrict your movement. What does it mean, restrict moving? But if you see, for example, red lipstick, it's not mean restriction. For example, if you see somebody using green lipstick, it doesn't mean go ahead. It's just play, it's just kind of game with color symbolism. Color symbolism is really one of the mysterious thing in visual language. This work was important part, important spot for tourism in Den Haag. And in early, in 2001, the installation was moved to the sculpture garden in the State Museum of Holland. Now it's located near the in other sculptures in collection. But almost 15 years, installation was on public view. That's another installation of the Stalin bustes upside down. Many things working. This is an installation I did in Piece One in New York, in Queens, actually, about the history of Soviet Union in slogans. You know, the slogans, we were surrounded by propaganda slogans. Forward to communism, or glory to the Soviet Union, glory to Soviet Union leaders, etc. We were surrounded by such a state-supported conceptual art. For example, glory to the labor, forward to victory of communism. But only one additional thing, signature. Glory to the labor, Comer and Melamed, Alex and me. Forward to communism, Alex and me, Comer and Melamed. And that's important parallel to Marcel Duchamp's Pissoir. We took this propaganda slogan like Marcel Duchamp Pissoir took per Pissoir and signed it by imaginary artist. But I love this date. You remember the date of execution of this work, of this ready-made? 1917, the year of Russian Revolution. That means two revolutions happened. I don't know which more important. Revolution which made by Marcel Duchamp and revolution which was made by Lenin. That's example of this propaganda art. Your parents were surrounded, and now we are surrounded by propaganda of Coca-Cola, McDonald's, etc. But we were surrounded by propaganda of commercial, of the political ideas. You see, usually it's a red background, white letters, and exclamation mark. White letters, red background, exclamation mark. And that's work we did in 1972, long ago. This is a quotation. You see this suprematistic corporation. Each letter looks like rectangle. It was before computer rectangles, I'm sorry. But quotation marks, in quotation marks. And the signature of very important, I believe, person who said this important quotation from his or her speech. And this is ideal logos. If you combine all logos, slogans together, you got this ideal logo, ideal slogan. That's another version of this quotation. This is a symbol of censorship. A little bit about allegory, geometrical allegory. This is what I talked about before. This is a famous piece of Malevich, one of the pioneers of abstract art. Red square, black square. From Western point of view of art historians, it's, as I said, dynamic composition, vibrant color. But in reality of Russian context, this is a relation of Malevich, who was a member of anarchistic party, to communism and anarchistic idea. Because red flag was the symbol of the communism, and black flag was a symbol of anarchism. And this reference very difficult to read for Western spectator. And I tell you a secret. If you like to really understand Russian avant-garde or Russian unofficial art, which was kind of inherited some of the tradition of Russian avant-garde. Some people call my generation the second avant-garde. For us, we appeal not only to spectator, but also appeal to the censor, even some secretly hidden censor among spectators. It could be some people who can report about this painting and found something illegal there. That's why many our painting has two different or even three different layers of the reading, some hidden messages there, kind of what in classical art of old art people called allegory. It's a geometrical allegory of the relation between anarchistic idea and communist idea. In 1923, after Russian Revolution, communists executed all anarchists and Russia became pure totalitarian country, one party system country. And Malevich was anarchist, but he was not executed because he was very important and well known on the West. One of the way to survive totalitarian regime to become more famous and more well known figure on the West. Another example of the hidden messages, for example, see color dots, color dots, color dots, color dots. But this is a code, that's a code, you see? And the code is translation in English of Russian constitution about the freedom of speech. That's a pure conceptual art. You understand, right? This is a code. Each color refers to each letter, A, B, C, D, etc. If you know the code, you can read it. But it looks like abstract painting. That's another example of the such a hidden messages and two layers of meaning. Another code, which I describe work in collaboration with Charlotte Moorman, Fluxus musician. That's a different code, the rule how to use Soviet passport. Each Russian letter of Russian alphabet refer to the different note of music. And it sounds like Cage, actually. It was a really important work. Sozart was more conceptual than more pop art, closer to conceptual art. And that's my first work in collaboration of the in collaboration with Andy Warhol. Without he didn't know about this time. That's me on the open on the second show after the bulldozer show when government destroyed our works by these agents of government and by bulldozers. It was a second show which was permitted by government in Izmailovsky Park. It was a fantastic moment of the freedom. It was a sunny, great day. I never forget this day. And I brought this work together with Alex, which we call Post Art. This is a glossy example of pop art, Campbell Soup, but just imagine after bulldozer show, somebody destroyed it, somebody torched it, or maybe it's picture from the future, because pop art of Andy Warhol was transformed to Pompeian fresco. It looks like Pompeian fresco. And my gallery was represent Andy Warhol, and owner Ronalds told me that when Andy Warhol saw this work first time, his face became green. And he said, I never think that someday, maybe after the war or nuclear explosion or maybe some earthquake or volcano eruption, my work will look like Pompeian fresco. Also, it was, as you see, the same aged Liechtenstein, Indiana. Many masterpieces of pop art was aged and transformed to Pompeian fresco, and we call it post art. How contemporary art will look in future. But finally, we met with Andy Warhol. It was the first time, and we met work in collaboration. You see, that's Andy Warhol, Alex Melamed, and me. And we established the corporation, Comrade Melamed Incorporation, because when we came to United States, we decided to become real capitalists, and we found some market without any competition to buy and sell human souls. It was kind of ephemeral product, which nobody tried to compete with that. And Andy Warhol sold his soul. This is Comrade Melamed Incorporation, New York. Warhol Andrew, I'm terribly agreed to sell my immortal soul for the sum of zero and signature, witnesses, etc. I don't know why zero, maybe it was the first transaction of his soul, but anyway, this soul became part of auction in Moscow and was resale. Now it's in hand of one talented Russian artist. She is doing kind of combination of landscape and abstract art, geometry art. And she bought it for, I believe, $300, something like that. Anyway, but problem is that many people ask, I will sell you my soul, I will sign this contract, but give me $1 million. But I had no $1 million at this time. It was confused. And we decided to make an aping gesture of the owner of the galleries. We made the soul on consignment. Like artists bring the work, put artist's heart and soul to this work, and gallery sale, 50% in case of sale, 50% to artist, 50% to gallery. And this is another new form of contract, the soul on consignment. If person asking $1 million, we write down $2 million. In case of sale, $1 million to this person and $1 million to our corporation. We spend a lot of money for this advertising and Times Square. This is Comrade Melamed as a logo. We buy and sell human souls. But problem is that we claim bankruptcy finally. The problem is that a lot of people like to sell their souls, but nobody buy it. And that project was ended. The last advertisement was just kind of more philosophical question. Have you sold your soul? And the galaxy are the question mark. And the project of the American Patriots, more stars for them. That's a project of American flag. More stars for everybody. Collaboration with Douglas Davis. It was this work in Metropolitan Museum collection. Douglas Davis came to Moscow. He brought fantastic bottle of whiskey. We sitting was drinking. When I was young, we could drink a lot. And you see, that's Alex Melamed, that's me, and Douglas. He made this photograph in New York when he was back from Moscow to New York. And we made this photograph in Moscow. And after that, it was a kind of Photoshop, but at this time wasn't a Photoshop, it's a kind of collage with glue. It's a 74. You see the line which I spoke about, text and image. This is a image and text together, but this is in Russian. Где черта между нами? Translation, where is the line between us? Of course, line means not only the state borders between countries. It could be this line between left and right hemisphere of our brain. It could be line between different individuality of American artist and Soviet Russian artist. Anyway, it's kind of philosophical image of the line. Line as a philosophical allegory or political allegory. Line between people, line which divided people. And in the same time, line could unite people. And that's another line, more mysterious. I ask you to follow this red dot. You see, this is abstract expressionism, spoken abstract expressions. But follow that, you see. This is curving line, making these two abstract expressions what never cross each other. This is not strong, simple line. It's much more complicated line, much more organic form line. What is that? This is a second meaning of, second layer of meaning. This painted by elephants. You see, that's the work which you saw in progress in Thailand. And this is a Talido Ahayasu, Elephant René. She was very talented. I tell you that elephant artist, the female elephants much more talented than male. That's a male, her brother. He's very lazy. He can't paint, but he's a lazy person. You see they paint together. You know, the trunk of elephant has a kind of little fingers. It's amazing, amazing tool. It has almost 15,000 group of muscles. It's a strong and very gentle in the same time. And an elephant can hold the brush. First time description of the drawing on the ground by a piece of wood or stone was described 2,000 years ago by ancient Roman historians, Plinius Older. It was two historians with this name. Of course, you know it. We just replace piece of stone by untoxic, not toxic color, water-based color and brush. And elephants start to paint. And this is a little different method. René paint together. That's Alex, René, and me. It's like a dance. We paint together on the same canvas. Like dance together. It was unforgettable. She was 16, actually, I remember. Now she passed away. It was 94. elephants not really long living creatures. It was one of the most beautiful collaborator in my life. And this is another layer of the meaning. You see who it is? Ganesh, god of the wisdom. You see the trunk in the middle, two arms on the left, two arms on the left, two arms on the right, two arms on the right. Another layer of meaning of this work. Because you have to do this work of unofficial artist, ex-unofficial artist. And I believe I was very happy with such experience. To understand spectator as a kind of sensor and create a few layers of the meanings which you can enjoy to open, to discover it, rediscover, even imagine some layer of meaning which never was there. It's a different kind of game, maybe more exciting than just to look at, okay, this is a red color, beautiful red color, great. But to find something behind it, it's developing your imagination. That's a work in collaboration with masses. It's a focal point in Ukraine. But the same project was done in United States and in Russia as well, and in France, etc., etc. I will focus it on United States and Russia. This is a graphs. Preference of the cow. Majority of the Americans and Russians love blue cow. This is a graph about size of the painting. It's many graphs, it was many graphs, many researches. It's a scientifically proof. For example, the questions, what size of painting you prefer? What's your favorite artist? What the texture of the painting? many questions. And finally, on the top numbers of majority, we create the most wanted painting of United States. What's majority like to see? That's United States majority most wanted painting. And this is a Russian most wanted painting. Both countries, you know, between our countries, much more common thing than we think. Both country, both majority of population of both country love blue landscape. Blue landscape. Some difference. Wild animals. In the United States, this is a deer. In Russia, it's a bear. I'm sorry for quality of the projection. George Washington, historical figure. In Russia, Jesus Christ, but also historical. People at leisure in the United States. Children at work in Russia. I can't explain this difference, but that's statistical. It's not dependent on my interpretation. And these two painting works also very similar. It's a least wanted painting, or most wanted by minorities. I don't know which minority we speak about, ruling minority or oppressed minority, but by numbers, it's minority. After Germany, the most people, majority doesn't like sharp geometrical figures with preference of orange color. Again, sorry for quality of slide, it's not a red. Red is beautiful, it's the orange, must be orange. And that's the orange. This is a Russian most unwanted by majority, or most wanted by minority, least wanted by majority. That's a two pair of painting. That was one of the last project which we did with Alex. After that, I remember I asked myself, what about individual work with individual spectator? Let's ask one person what you like to see in art and create what this person like, not abstract majority. Because abstract majority is a kind of socialist realism idea. Because government said, you are Soviet, Russian Soviet artist. You not serve rich decadent collector. You serve masses, you serve the people. But how to know what people like to see in art? Because statistics was a state secret at Soviet time. Many statistics never was published at this time. Even the method of the Paul Company's survey was not well known in Russia. For example, Minister of Culture can say to Stalin, Joseph Stalin, Comrade Stalin, people like to see your portrait. But how to check it? What people like to see? And only in the United States we can found the company, Paul Company, which worked for White House, actually, Martell and Kelly Company. It cost, of course, no, it was not cheap. It was quite big expenses. I can compare it with your payment for studying at the school for a year. It was a new step in art history. I don't know why, but nobody did such a survey in statistically scientific method. Survey was very successful, I think. And we can see now that majority doesn't like to see portrait of the leader, of contemporary leader. They like to see historical figures. That means it was wrong when Minister of Culture said to Comrade Stalin, people like to see your portraits. It was some difference. People like to see blue landscape. And I asked myself at the beginning, what I like to see in landscape. Sorry, we can skip it. And I found in art history two examples which I love. This is a painting by artist Levitan, a Russian post-impressionist painter. It's a representative of the some cemetery, little Russian Orthodox cemetery. And the huge sky, kind of vanitas, huge vanitas in form of landscape. And another also kind of vanitas, this is a Jewish cemetery by 17th century Dutch painter Reusden. I found also in my archive some photographs. That's my mother and my grandmother. gravestone near Moscow. And this is the most famous in Russia grave, Lenin tomb. Every day, thousands and thousands of people was visiting his tomb because his body was preserved like a wax figure of Museum of Madame Tussauds in London. And it was a fantastic kind of Caravaggio style light effect. And people admire it and standing hours and hours just to look at this. I saw it first time, the immortal body of a leader when I was, I believe, 10 years old. And it's make a big impression. And I understood that my landscape, my favorite landscape is a cemetery landscape. And that's what I did. This is a Lenin tomb. And I combine least wanted and most wanted, blue color and abstract painting, and after that, I understand that I have no favorite color. I like to just combination of a few colors. Next day, when I finished it, I was not satisfied by that. I made another landscape, the forest as a temple, et cetera, et cetera. And I couldn't stop after that. And now, if you have a question, my pleasure to answer. You have a unique opportunity to ask me a question because you pay a lot of money. Just you must squeeze me to get all my unique experience. You have a chance, unique chance.
What is the metaphor with the grapes and the eyeball?
For great what?
For the first thing you showed us with the grapes.
Closer, Mika.
With the grapes and the eyeball?
A very simple visual metaphor, both of them kind of sphere.
But what is the metaphor?
Metaphor is a similarity. You know what's definition of metaphor? Mm-hmm. When you found some similarity between different things. For example, I can compare the moon with Swiss cheese. That's a metaphor. Similarity between two different things. Not many people can see similarity between two different things. Now you can see similarity between eye and grape. You couldn't be not agree, it's okay. What do you think? What's close? What's kind of your metaphor for the grape?
Well, they're both squishy.
Good, good, you see. You must make poetry. Visual poetry. It's so good that we are all different. All of us have a different metaphor in our mind. I love your metaphor. And who have a more question? Yes?
I'm quite curious about the image from the Yalta conference with three leaders and the lion's head, the eagle's head, and the bear's head. You mentioned that the community board was opposed due to a belief that there may be some kind of vandalism as a result of the Polish, perhaps Solidarity movement going on at the time and so on. However, I'm curious, the image that you show is of the image, of your image, on a United Nations building, on actually the United Nations library.
Right. Not the just library.
Yeah. And I'm curious, what was the United Nations position on the piece?
United Nations never expressed its piece. They just follow artistic. It's not the Soviet Union, I tell you, that's political organization not involved in public art directly. I made a few quite successful work. Actually, if you look the new building of the housing court in Bronx, there is another metaphor, the Statue of Liberty as a justice. Nobody really tried to interrupt.
So it would have been allowed?
Community board. That's a big difference between censorship in Russia, in Soviet Russia, and United States. Here is a censorship of collective, censorship of the majority. And in Russia, censorship of minority, ruling minority. That's a big, important difference. You are the slaves of majority who electing president.
And could you speak to the hidden meaning in that image and its presentation there?
Yes, I believe it's a relation of the ancient beliefs, you know, ancient worship to animals, when heraldry was a kind of religious image. You know, to understand the phenomena, it's very important to clear the origin of this phenomena. In the earliest form of art, artist was usually a priest, a part of the cult, and the earliest artifacts was a part of the cult. And now artist is a kind of priest which lost faith. And we try to transform museums, transform to museums to this temple. And we consider museum as a temple. But of course it's a substitute of real religion and real temples. And in ancient time, people worshiped to animals, and even now the oldest family keep these ancient images as a heraldry in their their symbols, family symbols, it was also political mythology in 19th century political cartoon. For example, France was represented by or United States by eagle, etc., etc. Some Russia by represented by bear, etc., etc. Each country had its own symbol.
More questions? Do you have a question?
Yes, please.
I'm curious about your collaboration with the elephants, and when you collaborated with them, did you collaborate through the trainers, or did you communicate directly with them?
Yes, you saw in the picture the trainer there. You see the trainer? They didn't call them trainer, they called them mahouts. Of course, without mahouts, you couldn't establish your first contact with elephant. But later, elephants recognize you and you can work without mahouts. But it's a different story. Mahouts play a role of translator. You know, if you speak different languages and you don't know this language, usually the third figure between you and audience is a translator. And mahout is are translators. Did I answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Yes, please.
Did you ever personally suffer direct repercussions within the Soviet Union from your what was referred to as your nonconformist work?
You know, when I said that later I recognized the destruction of my work as a big compliment, of course it's a figure of speech, and I said later. In the moment when my work was destroyed, I was scared to death, I tell you truth. I was a few times arrested during the apartment show. Okay, did I answer?
Yes, thank you.
How did you conduct the research for the most desired and least desired
indians? What year?
No, how? Like, how did you go about doing
that? First, you must have a support. This project was supported by DIA Foundation and also by Nation magazine. To make survey in United States cost approximately from $40,000 to $50,000. In France, it was more expensive. In Russia, I believe it was almost free because Gallery Owner had a very good relation with chief of the Paul Company. Actually, he was my ex-student. And we didn't pay anything for that. For example, we made a survey in Kenya. It was just $15,000. The local company couldn't do it, but some international company in Finland, they did a few researches for us. Also was in China, a very important survey. It was difficulties in China because not many telephones at this time. Cellular phone was not so popular, and many people has no telephones. And the students of statistic department of Beijing University, they simply knocked the door on the map. If you're doing survey, the most difficult thing to create the map, which you number you call, for focusing to choose the people. Of course, it's not perfect tool, but it's make not correct result, only 0.5%. It's quite very close to reality. It's not perfect tool, but it's only tool, best tool we have now to figure out my public opinion of majority.
Question, Vitaly, could you talk a little bit about what is happening in Russian art now in this century?
A lot of things change if you follow the news. A lot of things change in Russia for the last 20 years. It was the end of Soviet Empire. Many ethnical group became independent. A lot of new state appear. Recently, I visit Georgia, for example. It was very exciting. And a lot of young artists and full of ideas. And they now can freely travel. Private galleries appear. It's interesting that disintegration of Soviet Union was in the same time with development of postmodernism. Why it's interesting? Because they appear also almost in the same time. Genetically, socialist ideas and modern art was connected. If you're reading the letters of Van Gogh, he was a socialist. You know, the Picasso was the member of Communist Party, and he never got a visa to United States, actually, on his first show, because he was a member of Communist Party at this time, in the 50s. Modernism was idea, as a socialist idea and communist idea, to destroy old culture, old tradition, and establish new tradition. Because, for example, abstract art, your generation take it as a granted. You never maybe can imagine the difficulties and revolutionary spirit of the appearance of abstract art. Now everybody can paint abstract art or some expressionist strokes. It's very easy. But at this time, at the beginning of 20th century, end of 19th century, it was a revolution gesture. That's why modern art and avant-garde art and socialist idea was together at the beginning. And they very symbolically, they disappear together. Post-Soviet state and post-modernism appear in the same decades. In the same decades. The death, birth and death of both phenomena was quite synchronized. Moscow artist, Russian artist, lost, of course, this energy of the protest. Energy which was lost in United States, I believe, after the end of Vietnam War. We face the same difficulties which everybody face in the world. The most talented young artists going to computer graphic, working with Photoshop, etc. Just if you eccentric, keep loyalty to so-called fine art, because fine art is a kind of legal form of insanity in our society. It's not so popular as used to be in time of early modernism. Russian artists facing a lot of difficulties because they must to compete on the auctions in New York and London. I miss something, not positively missing, but some kind of, I miss the rebel spirit, because I'm looking for some phenomena which I can really take very close to my soul and got idea to fight with or fight against. The destructive instinct is a very mysterious thing. You know, in 19th century, I hope you're familiar, people just simplify the psychological profile of the humanity. That they said the most important instinct is the two instincts. Instinct of the multiplication and instinct of the surviving, self-surviving. But later, after psychoanalysis, we understood the mysterious instinct of self-destruction. Self-destruction instinct has a lot of faces. You could go on the cross to be crucified in the name of ideas, in the name of the faith. You can sacrifice your life in the name of your family, your children, or to defend your parents, etc. But in the same time, self-destructive instinct can make you heavy alcoholic addicted person or drug addicted person. It's the same instinct from altruism to masochism, working this mysterious instinct of self-destruction. I believe that all dissident movement and all my friends, unofficial artists, we were self-destructive people. That's maybe why later I feel satisfaction after destruction of my works. It's still a mystery for me. I believe the self-destructive instinct play a very important role in history of humanity as a manifestation of altruism as well and as a drug addiction as well. Yes, please.
What do you think of the Pussy Riot action as the this evidence of the rebellion spirit, perhaps still in,
right.
in, you know,
absolutely,
in the society?
Yes. It's important event. Basically, when I see the, for example, auction houses, I see the underwear of Marilyn Monroe cost no less than some of Marcel Duchamp's work. You know, he found this revolutionary discovery. He made a discovery that's ready-made. And now we see how it works. And I believe that any kind of political scandal could become later historical value. And historical value, sooner or later, can become aesthetical value. That's, I believe, that Pussy Riot is a kind of ugly duckling. And they could become the beautiful swans after prison, if they survive in prison. If they survive in prison. I hope they will survive in prison. That's a test. But even they not survive the prison, the memory of them will be grow and trace, and sometimes we will see their performance as a beautiful flight of the swans. And it will be historical value became aesthetical value. For example, ancient Egypt art. It was not free society, it was not art of self-expression. It was a terrible time, terrible society, oppressed society, totalitarian. But now we enjoy their artifacts. That's a paradox of our mind. Sooner or later, historical value became aesthetical value.
And for, well, I'll take one more question. Jamie?
And you did a great deal of appropriating and collaborating, and I was wondering what it is about collaboration that you find most valuable. If you thought that the process and product was more or less rewarding than your independent work.
Sorry, I didn't tell it. Maybe it's misunderstanding. I never said that is the best way, collaboration or best way of creativity. What I said that it's unavoidable way. What I mean by unavoidable way. I remember a few years ago, I was invited by Hans Haake to Cooper Union, and I saw the work fantastically, very talented abstract expressionist, young student. And I asked him with second thought, of course, with very serious face, I asked him, are you working in collaboration? He said, no, no, I am lonely, brilliant, genius. I said, but I think you're working in collaboration with de Kooning. He said, oh, de Kooning, he passed away. I said, it doesn't matter. You could work with person who passed away already. If you're doing realism, you're working in collaboration with all realist artists who was before you. If you're working in abstract geometry, you're working with all this Malevich and Mandrian, with all of them. It's unavoidable to work not in collaboration. What I mean? I'm not speaking about value. Value is not our competence. It's your competence of the future. Did I answer the question?
Was there a contraindication there, the preferred abstract thing?
You know, I'm old eclecticist. I love so many different things. you know, many people just don't think about eclecticism of our mind. We believe in Darwin, we believe in Bible, we believe in a lot of very contradictive things in the same time. Our mind, our brain as a Russian salad. It's so many contradictions, you know, in our bowl of soup. What I really think is the essence of this situation. Since ancient Greek philosophy, if you remember Aristotle, it was two kind of things: thesis, antithesis, synthesis. That means, in frame of European tradition, we can see only two contradictory point of view. But in frame of Buddhism, it could be third point of view, which equally contradicting both of this. European tradition couldn't imagine something existence of the third opinion, which equally against opinion of number one and opinion of number two, which discuss or even making war between them. And that's, I believe, future. Future for us to understand that it could be a lot of different opinions. A lot of different opinions, not only two extremely opposite contradiction, which make a kind of dichotomy of our world. Did I answer?
Well, I mean, during the survey, was there a country where people actually preferred that?
During survey, it was much easier, because you just look at numbers. Top numbers is majority. Low numbers is minority. Very simple. You touch very interesting problem. I like to back to one image. Yeah. For example, look at this. It's a color preferences graph, right? Blue is a majority, right? But it's less than 50%. Have you noticed? In case of two-party system, it's very easy to choose. More than 50%, that's majority. Less than 50, minority. But in case of three-party system, in case of four-party system, or Italian way, there's more dozen of parties, you are wrong. Majority against blue color. Blue color occupied almost something 30-34%. Yes, that's it. But majority against blue. But what's the problem? They're divided by their love to different colors. That's the paradoxical nature of democracy. Sometimes, if you have a multi-party system, you choose majority, which is minority, actually. Majority against that.
Well, will you all join me in saying goodbye to Vitaly?